Bueno, bienvenidos a la charla con Natalie Mikhailova. And, pardon? Ah, no, you can sit. Yeah. Voy a hablar en inglés. La charla la vamos a hacer en inglés. Bueno, welcome to this talk about cultural agility. And Natalie is with us here for 2 days at AirFit. She's working at Javeriana Cali, in Cali. They're also in Bogota. And so she was with us this morning to talk about research on the topic. So it was more academic research. Now we have the talk to you, master students, MBA students. And we will also have a talk tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. For our undergraduate students. So she's sharing a little bit with us her insights in research, in teaching, and what she's doing back in La Universidad Javeriana in Cali. Yeah, so I will just formally present Natalie. Natalie Mikhailov, she is an assistant professor of international business at the School of Economics and Business Administration at the Universidad Javeriana in Cali. She received her PhD in management and organization from University of Turku, that's in Finland, and an MBA in human resource management from the Golden Gate University in San Francisco in the United States. She has 10 years of professional experience in human resource management and also extensive teaching experience in the areas of cross-cultural and human resource management. And in her work, she tries to provide a link between international business, cross-cultural, and talent management. She also has lived and worked in many, many countries and conducted research in several countries, 8 as of now with Colombia. And besides the US, she has spent most time in Finland and in the Czech Republic. And currently, her research is focused on social networks, social capital, and collaborative knowledge creation. Yeah, so we will hear a little bit about the topic. I think Natalie, she will tell us a little bit for an hour or so about the topic. And we can also have afterwards questions and a discussion on that topic. And if you want, I can provide some translation if you don't feel comfortable speaking in English. No problem then. Okay, so Natalie,
we will look first at the topic of global mobility. We talk a lot about mobility, people moving here, there, but who is moving, where, and why? And there are differences in the recent time that we normally, or most research been done, looking at the different angle. Countries used to be, when we spoke about mobility, we talked about expatriates, mostly moving from west, north to east, south countries. So there were managers of multicultural companies, maybe they went to establish business, maybe they went to train local workforce, but mostly we were thinking of US, European countries, and somebody moving, well, to Latin America, to Asia, to Africa. Now we have basically movements the other way around, so there are more people coming to United States, to Europe, maybe not more, but there is a shift in the direction. Oh, I think I did something. industries, again, mostly when traditionally this was agriculture, then manufacturing, but now we see the shift for IT and knowledge creation, although still a lot of industrial kind of manufacturing and lighter industries are present. Career, when we thought traditionally, if you kind of couple decades ago of the expatriates, normally the picture was mid-career, manager, professional, and now it's more likely to be somebody starting their careers, going on a short assignment, so more of the early career or serial careers, since traditional shift is also from the long-term, lifelong careers to people having several careers, having lateral moves, having people changing their companies, industries, and so on. And also time. In the past, most people who were moving for a long time, taking their families with them, moving houses, renting houses, and then they might return back, and that was normal step, for example, for developing executive. Now we see more of the shorter term assignments. We are talking months, not years, so no need to buy a house or move the whole family. And you will see more shift to once in a career assignment to several or serial, or somebody might be move around the companies several times or basically never leave in their home country. So that's it, not to say that everything has changed, but we see the shift in trends. Now that's approaches. If we look, we just was discussing with Sasha, that's all the different things that you can do. And how that we used to look at different cultural sensitivity preparation to the assignments. And first, that idea was that people should acculturalize, meaning that you have your own culture, you become immersed and shared value with another culture. So you will become a typical, or if not typical, just normal person in a new country. So you come to United States, you share values, you become American, you come to Colombia, you become Colombian. Not that you will lose your own culture, but you will still have perfect understanding, understand values, behavior, approaches of the other country. But that could work if you expected to spend years there. If you come just for a few months, probably it's not the best approach, because then you will take all your time learning culture. Basically, the same thing happens with the language. If you move from country, country, country to country, that's, I know it's my experience. Everybody asks me why I don't speak the language perfectly of the place I am now. It's like, well, but I've been here just a year, and before that I was in a different place, and I was learning different language. And who knows where I will be next year. So spending all the time perfecting language of your current assignment, your current place, is not productive, because you might never use it. For example, I left Turkey. That is not in Finland, that is actually in Asia, but well, I did study Turkey. And there I did not spend a lot of time learning language, because I didn't plan really to spend a long time. Adaptation now is a bit different. You are not expected to share culture, or employers are not. They just can function in this culture. So they go over culture shock, they're comfortable in their environment, they still find a lot of kind of cultural behavior and customs or organizational approach is strange, but they know that's how it works. So we talk about adaptation, which should obviously happen even on a short-term assignment. Only you have to realize that it's a very kind of bare minimum approach. I'm comfortable, I'm adapted, I'm not feeling stressed, anxiety, I can function almost normally. So just as you will think about going to another country where it has drastically different climate, so instead of like Medellin having warm weather, you go, say, to Finland, and then it's very cold, but you already know, you got your coat, you know how to deal with that, you are not depressed because it's dark there during the winter, or you are not more depressed than the locals. It's very basic approach. Cultural sensitivity, you probably heard this term more. That's when managers or professionals or customer service provide their services, customer service, managing, understanding the needs of the culturally diverse clientele or employers. So they might not only they can live in the new environment, but they could understand the needs and be sensitive in providing services or managing. Or on the other hand, they would be able to develop new services and they would know which behavior is caused by cultural values and which are personal behavior, which is of course very different thing, just being comfortable around people. But we're moving further, so being sensitive is good, understanding culture of other people is good, understanding which behavior is influenced by culture is also good. But now we move cross-cultural competence is in a way used interchangeably or along the line with cultural sensitivity. It means that your skills as a manager, as a professional, as a teacher can be applied in other cultures. So not only you are sensitive, but you are just as effective teacher or manager or cultural customer service professional or doctor in another setting, and actually not only in one setting but in different settings. So you can adjust your style or know how to deliver things that's more or less culturally neutral. You would not only insult people, but you can motivate students, you can provide services. Okay, I keep pushing the wrong button. Okay, yes, I'm using the wrong thing. So now we move to the global mindset, and we hear it a lot. Now it's one of the most popular terms, and everybody got to develop global mindset. Organizations, companies, politicians, countries. Few people know what global mindset is, but it's when the term was coined that was a very simple definition: ability to influence individuals, groups, and organizations different from you. So the good news, you probably all have some beginning of global mindset. You probably managed to influence people of different age, different gender, different status in organizations, people from Bogota, so all different people that are different from you. And influence to do something. Influence, lead people, sell to people, teach people, motivate them, do things that people need a little bit encouragement. But for organizations and professionals to have global mindset, it goes above sensitivity because you do things, make people do things that they would not otherwise. And obviously, as a management student, you remember that management is ability to do things through people. So if you are doing it in a global place, you got to have global mindset. And a new term that is sometimes we throw around, cultural agility, that's more of the behavior competency. If global mindset is more of the cognitive, emotional, motivational, you influence people, agility applies to manager her or himself, and ability to change your behavior according to culture, but not just prevailing culture. It's not like I would behave or lecture different in Colombia, but talking with a person, I would figure out what is the most appropriate response in this situation. Should I respond as Finnish academicians talking to my colleagues? Should I respond and talk as American professional manager? Should I try and find appropriate response as a resident of Colombia? Or maybe, just maybe, in this situation, something that I would do in Turkey. Turkey, meaning the country, would be very appropriate, even though it's not the normal cultural response. So maybe something, so you have kind of box of tools, different cultures. Should you be emotional and make connection with your employees or customers? Should you be very professional and objective? Should you show your emotions? Should you hide it? Should you be compassionate, authoritarian? So the whole range. Normally, managers and professionals feel uncomfortable getting of their prefer managing, teaching, communication style, and prefer to default to that. So if you come from an organizational culture and have personal preference for participating in management, you feel uncomfortable being authoritarian. That was my experience, for example, leading in the United States, even though that's United States much more egalitarian, say, than Colombia in general. But I found very difficult as a new manager to be authoritarian. It's like, no, you got to do that. That's required. Instead of saying, well, what do you think? Let's discuss that. So at that point, I lacked cultural agility, because I could do things one way but could not easily switch to another and could not easily understand what response is appropriate in this situation. So, and the last one that we kind of start talking about is cultural knowledge creation. That is even more that, because the ideas that culture is not something that kind of stays as a climate. Colombia has warm climate and, you know, large power distance culture. It's something that's created in the situation, it's fluid, and everybody has different cultures that we belong to. We can think again, age, gender, profession, organization, maybe we even have several national culture. So maybe you were born in one place, lived in another, went to school to a different place, worked with people, married to another person, and now bringing up kids yet in another country. You picked up a little bit. So as a spouse, you respond in one way, as a professional in another, as academician. And third, and all that mixed, and then we all share all these different cultures. So what comes up is kind of very thin but new culture, and that can share knowledge and create knowledge. So we all become better because we share things that's done not only in our one culture, the major culture, but in all others. So that is kind of much more vague term, because it really has not been defined authoritarily as the previous ones. It's something that we create knowledge by sharing knowledge, by participating in culture, by communicating. So that is much more important for organization, and it's right there with organizational culture, because organizational culture is culture as well, but organizations are in some locations, they employ people, so it's all built on cultural knowledge creation. Now, before we started the research, traditionally that idea was that most important thing that people in a new country should go through is culture shock. So, anybody has an idea what culture shock is, or it's better just, yes, no? No. Some people think that it's really shock, that you come into the new culture and you are totally devastated, shocked, you never expected to see that. No, it's not anything that drastic. You can, or you cannot function. At some point there might be that definition of culture shock, because traditional, the research on culture shock was done with volunteers. This was in the United States, Peace Corps, volunteers who went and hold humanitarian projects in some remote and really very different cultures. And it was somewhere in the 50s when there was no internet, no Google. Well, basically we lived, I was not alive there, but the researchers lived in informational stone age. So there was very limited preparation. People knew that, for example, Africa is hot and they have different people, but that was basically it. So when they came and become teachers, professionals, tried to build houses, they actually were not prepared for a lot of things. So they might experience culture shock. But nowadays, when we talk about professionals moving from company to company, from city to city, culture shock works a little bit different. So first, when you come, and it's actually classic V-shape, that's first you come and you're very happy. You're a new environment, there is exciting things going on, you know, fruits grow on the trees, or there is snow like on Christmas postcard. Something wonderful that you probably associate with vacation and fun time and all the things. So you are very excited. It's a honeymoon period because you gain a lot of new things and you don't realize that you lost some of the things. Then at some first disappointment, you see that things are not like I expect that to be. Well, there might be some things to with physical environment. Well, it's too hot, or it's too cold, or maybe it's with way people behave. Maybe you expected them to be friendlier. Maybe you expect them to keep promises, have better time kind of management, or be more flexible and not stuck up with time, whatever the thing. So you realize that first initial culture shock, that's normally it's very simple kind of symptom. You just realize that people around you are really doing things the stupid way. And you want to tell them how is to do it rightly. Like, why do you do this? Let me tell you how to do this. Why you know, whatever it is, why you speak so loudly or so softly? You should speak normally. And normally, obviously, what you expect. So, or whatever it is, you really realize that people should really shape up. They should, you know, come on time or be more flexible, whatever it is. So that's when you realize that people around you really need to hear from you. That's the first initial culture shock. Then you realize, okay, life goes on, things changing, you know how to adjust that, you do whatever minor things you need to do, and you're okay again. We're on the second small peak. You are not that happy at the honeymoon period, but you're okay. You're doing okay, you're functioning, and you're so proud of yourself. Maybe you learned how to, you know, conduct business in simple thing, a new language. Maybe you figure out how the buses run, something that was totally unexpected, but now it works. And then the major thing comes, that you really understand that your ideas are very different. That your ideas how to manage people, your expectation of your boss, your expectation of your employees, they're worlds apart. You really don't understand how they can do that. Either they're too authoritarian and don't talk to you, or they never tell you what to do. What kind of boss is that? You expect clear direction and they say, let's brainstorm. Well, I'm exaggerating, but there is really major disagreement. And then at that point, people either decide, I'm not going to stay here, I'm leaving. Or they learn and sometimes even get better than in their home country. They might say, actually, I like this place better. Things are better than they used to be. I think I prefer that. And they might even over-adapt. So that's actually the way of culture shock. And it happens every time you enter new culture. But the thing is, as I said, it was developed long time ago. Now, it's hard to say when you enter and leave new culture. You might be moving to the organizational culture. You might be in contact with your colleagues virtually before you even enter. So it might happen, it might not happen. It might happen every time you enter a new situation. But it definitely gets flatter because you know what to expect. And you kind of realize the moment you want to tell people how stupid they are is the moment to really look at yourself and see what you need to change. So, but that was the original approach. Now, let's, as I just summarized, what was the traditional approach of selecting, recruiting, and sending employers abroad? So first, it was really abroad. So you go to one place, you normally, that's employers that were had career with the company, executive or manager, mostly Western countries were selling to developing world. I'm not saying it was all what's happening, but all the literature addressed basically that traditional model. Mid-career, mostly men, children, so there were issues of education and adjustment of family and long-term assignment. And there was expectation that you go there and you return back. Maybe you go to another assignment, but most likely you are not retiring in another country. You are not moving there. You just go for some time. And there was basically four main approaches that you still look at and they're still discussed in literature and still used for many companies. Ethnocentric, polycentric, geocentric, and regiocentric. Okay, let's look what they are, and we can see that the advantages of the ethnocentric approaches. Ethnocentric, basically, you send employers from headquarters to other companies. So if your company is in Colombia, managers would be from Colombia. So good communication with headquarters, since you work there, you have connections, and you know the culture of the company and the country. Good connection and coordination. Normally those managers qualified and experienced in the company because they had a long career there, so well known, and obviously they provide international experience to the employers. So this is parent PCN, parent country national. So those who are from the company where the headquarters. That's disadvantages that people in the other countries have limited promotional opportunity if you always have managers and CEOs sent to you. And it takes time, so all this culture shock things might happen, adaptation, and there is also issue with the income, which we'll look to later. If you pay the managers the same they expected to pay at home, normally it would be different pay. As I said, the idea was you go from rich development kind of weird companies, Western educated, industrialized, rich and democratic, to the rest of the world where the wages are lower. And also might need to both adaptation and lack of sensitivities. So if you look at polycentric, that's advantages would be polycentric, meaning that you have people from the local countries promoted at the to the management position. No language barriers, no adjustment period. That's not expensive because, again, we assume that the wages are lower and you have promotion opportunity, but then the problems become with headquarters. Why you understand your employers perfectly, you have troubles working with headquarters. And also there is limited opportunity to move around. Okay, geocentric, obviously you look everywhere in the whole world and there are a lot of people there, but those people might not have your experience of the company. They do have international experience and they provide career development. So the problem that's if you have somebody not from your company come and work in, that's normally you need work permit. One way or another, and different countries require different things for promotion of managers. In some places it's very easy, in some places it's very difficult. For example, now in the United States, the cap is half of what it used to be last year, so some companies would not be able to bring even the most qualified professionals because there is just a limit. It's first come, first served, so it's not the most qualified to get the permit. Then you need to train people in the company and normally relocate them. Remember, we're thinking of moving the whole family. And it takes time. Geocentric, that's you look kind of regional. So we promote people around, say, Latin America or Pacific. So they kind of get kind of sort of cultural understanding. Maybe there is a shared language that's to some extent, and it's not so fine. There is kind of build connections. Local conditions, then you can move to another approach, which one you want. And on the other hand, you have regions that don't talk to each other, and there is no career path. Then we have, so that's different classic approaches. Again, I want to stress, they look at managers, professionals, mid-career normally, that's moved in the traditional way. And that's the problem that's been discussed quite a lot is expatriate failure. And I have to say that it's very difficult to define. We are concerned with it, but we don't know what it is. So that's one of the things. Is it a failure when a person, an employer, has to return before the end of the assignment? Well, maybe it is a failure, or maybe that's a good thing. But normally we look as when the person returns before the end of the assignment. Although, in my opinion, it's much more dangerous thing when the person stays and really ruins the organization, mismanage employers, ruin customer base, and you might not find it until find out until later on. So that's kind of thing you have to watch for. Why is that? Well, there is a lot of discussion on that. Obviously, inability to adjust. You just cannot live there. Or maybe since you have family, your family is unhappy there. So, or maybe there is other family reasons. Again, we assume that family is concerned. And actually looking at all that, many companies decided, well, seems like family is a big problem and we should not really send people with the families because we just multiply the reason to fail. Well, you obviously realize what happened then. Instead of having family to support a person and talk about all the bad parts and celebrate good, you have a person alone. And failure rate went up because people, instead of talking to their spouses, now of course you can talk on Skype, but it's not the same. People would start work too long, which look as a good thing, but actually not, because as we will see later on, task orientation reduce adjustments. If you work too long and don't interact with your colleagues, it's not a good thing. Or there is all kinds of health problems, depression, abuse of substances, and other things that's actually much worse than just returning home and time. Depends obviously on manager, and we talk about managers, professional maturity. So are you really a person who can handle stress and know what to do? Sometimes it's just work. It's nothing to do with culture and difficulty with new environment, quite physical difficulty, or it might be really lack of competence. A person just could not do the job because normally promotion and move to another country included promotion. So that was rarely at that time. Then we have other factors. The longer assignments obviously gives you more opportunity to adjust. Remember the culture shock. But on the other hand, if you leave at 6 months, you might leave at the lowest point, because the first deep down comes about 6 months period. And if you leave after 6 months, all of your experience would be the terrible experience, because you exactly left when you started to learn something. On the other hand, if it's less than 3 months, you might leave at the honeymoon period, and then it's even worse, because all your experiences are wonderful, and you have not even moved to the difficult stuff. And just remembering going on vacation. Anybody suffered culture shock going on vacation? No? Well, even if you went to international vacation, no, it's wonderful. Food is good, people friendly, a lot of fun stuff, and it's over too soon. And you just wait till the other vacation. But just imagine if you had to stay there. It seems like a good idea. Oh, I would never want to leave. But if you try, you might find very soon that you could not spend all your time doing fun stuff, finding housing is terrible, you know, food is not as good as you thought, you could not eat in a restaurant. Well, you can imagine, I would not go. So willingness to move, it seems like, well, obviously, but did you want to go there? Is it a career move for you? Told you are going, I don't know, to Brazil, and say, okay, Brazil, I'll go whatever, whenever I need it. But if you really want it, it's like, yes, I really want it. It's a great opportunity. And Brazil, that's wonderful, including your family. So is it your decision, or at least decision that you like, or is it something that you are told to do? And also, as I told you, adjustment to the work role has a negative correlation. So if you're doing your work very good, that's bad news, because it means you are not adjusting to the culture. And you can actually see, even I could give you examples moving in the different universities, you always see somebody who is sitting there and working late at night is not doing so well. They are really working on their assignments, maybe doing research, grading. The person who adjusted well is the person who is always out, having a lot of new friends, chats with colleagues, and really always complains that there is no time. So that person is living normal life, because it's not normal, really, to spend a lot of time in the office working and working and working. It just means that's the only thing that makes you happy. And I also know it's my own example. As soon as I want to really, really stay in the office as long as I can, that's a problem. I really need to get out and start meeting people, even though all I want to do is sit and write a paper. No, it's not good. So it's negative correlation. And particularly because you might think that you are doing your work so well, but you are not, because you might be doing it the different way. So in my experience teaching students, I'm doing wonderful lesson plans, providing all the example exercise, but for some reason my students are bored. Why is that? Because they're different students. I have not got to know them. I don't know what really works for them, what they enjoy. I don't understand when they get bored. Because instead of standing up and leaving, they're sitting. So whatever it is. And also, obviously, how committed is the company and how its adjustment to living condition and interaction. So now that was all traditional. Now we have a different parts of people or employees potentially that should be considerate, and we have very limited research on that, so we have very limited knowledge of what's going on with them. Self-initiated expatriates. That would be me, and as far as I understand, Sasha, somebody who did not wait for the company, who did not build a career in one company, but woke up one day and said, I think I go to, you know, Colombia. I think it's a nice place to be. And so you decide to go, and then you find work here. Maybe you did not go there, but looked for work in different countries. And so nobody sent you. You went there. And as you see, that's very good, because the willingness is there, probably the intention. Probably problem work permit. Most companies need to employ new employees in the country, sponsor them. They're different from country to country. There is no history with the company, so that's a problem. But the plus side is the self-motivation. They're virtual teams, so people work in their home office or maybe really at home and work with the company. There are SWAT teams, so very short assignments that come, solve the problem, set up the company and leave. They are not adjusting at all. They, as the definition goes, they come, they fix the problem, they leave. So that's, and quite often now we see that specialists are moving to headquarters. For example, there is a discussion of Amazon and Seattle. That's it's changing the city. Many people are coming to headquarters. That's not managers coming to Amazon. That's professional employers for all different parts of the world. And that's increased diversity of the company, changes city. But to what culture should they actually adjust? To Seattle culture, but they live and work in Amazon and even take their dogs with them. They already adjusted to Amazonian culture, culture of the company, but still they're living in a different thing. So as you see, here we see kind of a cultural knowledge creation situation when knowing organizational culture, knowing the different approaches to managing diversity. You are actually in a new city, and Seattle has very strong city culture. And sometimes it's not very happy with changes, and some changes are not for the better, so there is kind of way of negotiation. And also such things as employers leasing or recruitment agencies, that you actually work for company in from your own country, only you in another country. In the United States, very popular with IT industry. So Indian programmer will work for an India company, and maybe with Indian employers, only they happen to work in California. But again, that's changing culture. And also recruitment agencies, that they can recruit employers in the countries, and then they can rotate them based on the assignments. So what is selection? All the skills are important: technical, cross-cultural, family, company requirement, language to some extent, as again I explained to you. If it's a short-term assignment, it's very unproductive to require language, particularly if the company language is different, but you do need some survival skills, obviously. You cannot totally not speak language, not being able to say help or, you know, stop or how are you or thank you, please. So something is definitely needed. There might be special requirement for a country. Let's just look at quite fast on them so it's quite clear. Technical managerial skills, the main selection, because we know that. It's very easy to verify. We have it on the background. We have performance, basically, evaluations. But it's really not guarantees international performance. So we select for something that is no predictor of what we want to know. But it's easy, so we do it. Cultural suitability, it's important. And there are some traits that can predict them, and they can be basically tested. The problem is just because I have this trait doesn't mean that I'm going to apply them. But there are traits there, so there are some of profiles of people who are more likely to develop the skills. And also agility, as I already mentioned, ability to translate it in different environment, ability to find the appropriate response. But it's hard to test. You might be able to demonstrate it in the past. You can say, but I lived in many countries, I worked in different environment, but it's not something that you can do. And also coping skills. So family requirement, rarely used, because first, it's not considered to be, in most companies, polite to ask about your family and include the spouse, not just ask, but include. So that might be a big problem, because spouses are the ones normally, unless they're also employed, dealing with all the issues of adjustment, finding new ways of managing the life at home. So language country, that's different languages, that's host country language, corporate language, host country language is a good thing, but again, as I keep saying, unrealistic requirement, although communication skills is not necessarily language skills. You might speak perfectly and not being able to communicate because you lack another verbal communication, expressing yourself. So communication skills are more important. I can even say that when you're in the situation that you don't understand perfectly language, you really read the person. You, instead of listening just to the words, you watch persons of the person saying he's pleased, but he's not smiling. So probably I should not take the words, or maybe you don't even know what the person is saying. You're trying to guess, and it's amazing how you can get by, although I would not again advocate staying multilingual. So the more languages you can speak, obviously, the better. There is obviously hardship region, which require special protection and special willingness to go. And there might be some cultural or religious requirements that you need to take into consideration. For example, Japan has very prohibited immigration policy that, you know, deny certain religions work permit. Actually, I think most religions, except Christian and local. So dual career couples, when both spouses have career, they very difficult to accommodate. I think it happens much rarer that we discuss. It was discussed quite a lot few years ago, but now I think it's not a major problem with virtual work, with ability to connect. So you can either stay at home or obviously work where you are. And there's that different things that company can do, allow support and assignments. That's why I just wanted to put that, because I always get this question, what about women? Most cultures don't consider women as managers. Wouldn't they be disadvantaged if you send a woman to Saudi Arabia? Would people talk to her? Well, actually, yes, because strangely, that woman expat is not considered to be a woman in the culture that does not allow or does not really support women in leadership position. That's manager first or professional first, and probably would consider very unnatural woman. So there would be sad prospects of finding a husband, but by managing employers would be very good. Quite the opposite, there is a hollow effect, saying, well, if they send a woman, knowing that it's not normal, she must be exceptional. It might be not the case, but that's the idea. If they said the woman where we're all men, something quite different with her. She probably the best. And leadership style, again, that's very broad generalization, but more appropriate because women in general tend to be high on perception and on reading social cues. Well, it's good to have good role models. So testing is quite oftenly used, but the problem that testing based on cultural, and if you test for culture, you cannot step outside culture, so it's very difficult to have valid cross-cultural test, even performance test. Then there was scholars in selection and cross-cultural adaptation, they suggest different dimensions that work well. Perception, self-orientation, other orientation, and cultural toughness of the country. So some countries are difficult to penetrate, some countries are difficult to make friends with. Well, there was kind of the best for expats list. Colombia made the first 10, so it might be difficult for Colombians to go to other culture because Colombian culture is easy, and others might be much more difficult. Interviews quite commonly used, better to do team-based, but time-consuming and expensive. For example, Google used to have 14 interviews in 8 countries to fill a position. So they move a person everywhere to make sure that everybody could work this person. That's good, but not everybody is Google, not everybody has that capability. We say, okay, Skype, but a lot of cues are removed. You don't know if the person, what the person wearing, how they behave, you just say face. So it's very difficult to figure out how this person would interact. It's okay for technical skills, but we really don't need them. And managers are not trained to access that. So that's a problem again. That person might say, oh, well, I don't like because, but they cannot really read the cultural sensitivity. Other selection tools. Cultural training, something like a course. You graduate, you go, you fail, you go back home or not where you were working. The problem, quite often outsourced. A lot of companies promote that, and the outsourcers might not know the culture of the company, not understanding how it all works. So they train for specific culture, but it's not enough. Assessment centers, that's basically you work with people of different representative. It seems that it's very easy. I can tell you in my undergrad class, I provide my students with a role play where they have to interact with the culture they don't know. This culture does not exist, so they cannot guess it. It's really totally different culture from any known cultures. Even though they study the whole semester how to be sensitive, how to communicate, how to read cues, not to mention that every week we talk about cultural differences. As they get in this role play, they're very uncomfortable. They know that this culture does not exist. They are given that explanation that you need to read the cues. But they cannot do it, and they report right back. We were very uncomfortable. The other group was so rude. They did not want to talk with us, and they were just acting in different cultural mode. So that's how assessment centers can work, and it's not knowing about the culture. It's ability to guess how you will interact with people about whom you don't know, because you cannot really describe cultures without referring to your own. And in order, for example, to describe, say, Colombian culture, we need an expert from any other culture. That's because it depends how you look like from what your point of view. The best thing would be location visits and short stay there. Again, location visits can be expensive, but not as expensive as a relocating person getting started and then taking back. Short-term assignments, okay, we know honeymoon, but if you know that you are here just to learn, maybe it gets idea. And also continuous training and emerging programs, so you know how to fend for yourself. Quite often that's supporting new employers, expatriate or foreign, results is the company does everything for them. We'll rent, it's of course in the best case scenario. We rent you an apartment, we find school for your kids, we do this, this and this. You know, in my experience, I even had the manager buying me the phone card or charging my phone because it's so difficult, obviously, and so culturally, you know, immersed. But that's results. You don't know how to do anything because you just get everything done, and then next time you need to charge your phone, you had no idea, and you feel helpless. So immersion means that you are taught how to live in the country, but also in the company. And sample work, you can send people in different kind of months abroad, like we send students semester abroad and see how they like it. So that's other selection tools that could be used, but not always used. Okay, so the process, you recruit, select, you train, you assign, and then you move back. Now, a few things of the new realities of the workplace that I mentioned, just to summarize that. Cultures are different. So diversity of cultures everywhere we can see in Europe, in United States, but also here, you can see more and more people from different cultures and you don't know to which culture adjust. Remote work. People don't necessarily come to the office, meet their colleagues, have a talk around water cooler or over coffee at lunch, but they still have to work all together. New arrivals, I just put it very kind of vague, but most cultures experience new people coming. There might be mass emigration, there might be people. So it's a bit different. Those people don't come to work for a few times, but they might not come to immigrate exactly. They might be coming for sometimes long period of time, but maybe planning to stay, maybe planning to return home for the retirement. So there is new dynamics of the migration, and it obviously shows at the workplace. But immigration approaches are also changing. Some, you know, countries and most changing to the tougher laws. Corporate language also is changing, and you might have more and more companies using English. And that's, I wanted to show you global mindset once again, since we're going to look at the global leadership. That's a set of individual attributes. That enables global leadership and, as I said, ability to influence individuals, groups, and organizations. And those are components, that's intellectual capital, psychological, and social. So all these parts that you can see, that's intellectual. Do you understand what's going on? Do you have understanding of the complexity? Psychological capital, can you really work with other people? Do you enjoy it? Are you sure of yourself, or you kind of think people look funny on you? And social capital, can you develop connections with other people? And creation of cultural knowledge, I just want to share with you, that's actually the model, that's one of the possible models that looks at individual conditions, working environment, and consequences. So that's we can look. And also organizational factors influence the global mindset. That's managing diversity, how they do it, how they involve all employers, how they prepare managers to manage different employers, and how they develop system, human resource management system, that's address needs and motivation of all groups of employees. Because quite often you can see the company develops wonderful even package of rewards. Again, we can look at Google, for example. They have free lunch, and they have bicycles, and they have yoga lessons. To Amazon, you can bring dogs, and it's all wonderful. But what if a person wants to eat with their families? Or maybe they don't want to do yoga. Not everybody into yoga, you know. Or maybe you don't like dogs. For example, there is a lot of cultures that dogs are not really appropriate in the office. How about you guys? Would you like dogs in the office? No? I think that would not be big dogs. I mean, not a lab dogs like Dane. You know, you go talk to your manager and the manager has a Dane. So is it a good environment? Not really. So not everybody wants to sit in the open floor sharing. That's obviously organizational culture. If you don't like it, you don't belong to Google. But sometimes it's not organizational culture, and companies just do these perks just because everybody else does that. So if Google had open floor, let's all have open floor, and we really don't know how it happens. So that's important, that the system address the needs and motivation of employers, not just copying what is considered to be the best. And obviously, continuous development. That's where we already talk, mobile workforce, virtual work, so you don't have actually to move. You might be independent contractor, not even working for the company. Gig economy, we know Uber, we know Airborne, but there is a lot of other things that can be done online. And you don't even know who the persons who are working on that. You can be translation, writing, advertising, a lot of works can be done online. There are people like me, let's move around just because. So the people that's not planning to retire maybe in any particular country for now and just keep moving and available. So that happens all the time. There is also entrepreneurs that people might live in the country not for work but for global just experience. International agencies, as I said, leasing employees. Then there is a lot of employees even in some ways formalized, but because of the immigration law, there is a lot of informal work. And that people might be providing services without really formal recognition. It's kind of becoming more common in many countries. That's why there is the law against that becomes harsher, not because it's disappearing, but because it's becoming more common. And then there is regional mobility that happens on the organizational level. For example, a company in Europe might hire employees in Poland and then send them to work in Finland on Polish conditions. So they're there for the assignment, they paid Polish wages, but they're working in a different country and they don't interact with other kind of colleagues, but they're there and they have to follow kind of employment laws, except of course the payment. What are the possible developments? We really don't know. That's a question. We can have global world or closed borders. There's movement both directions. Some are, you know, calling for more interconnections, yet many countries move to tougher immigration controls, closed border. Will mass migration continue and at what way? Would people stay or return? How it will work? We really don't know, but whatever happens, that would influence the future workforce. There is call in Europe in particular, but we hear it in different way, that have more equal work conditions, but wouldn't it be a loss of country competitiveness? Again, it's mostly happening in Europe, where Europe is united, but wages conditions are different. And newcomers, for example, Visegrad countries, former Eastern European, call and say that we don't want to pay the same wage because that's our country competitiveness. We have educated workforce, but we don't cost so much. Why should we pay as much as French? Then nobody will come. We are as good, but you can stay there. So that might be a question. Or it might be regional cooperation when might not be global, but regions might work together. Virtual work, so maybe we will work, sit at home, work and don't need to move anywhere, or move not connected. And there is also some ideas that artificial intelligence makes us all unemployable and we have either die from hunger or have all the fun in the world. That is very fun. Well, I wanted to look at performance compensation, but I really don't know. Should I go on another topic or maybe take questions? Okay, so compensations are there. So shall I give you the slides? Or? Okay, so it's very technical, so I'm just going through slides so you will see what you are missing. But I just want to make sure we get to the final. That's more traditional, but I'm just going to show the strategic approach and then the traditional one wouldn't really be necessary, but I'll be happy to give the slides. And okay, so that's the important thing, that's compensation system, as I said, that should reward cultural norms in the organization and what people would like, so family-oriented value, people with family values would rather have support of their families, more individualistic, different. But cultural norms don't mean national culture necessarily. There might be organizational, generational, professionals like Google. And so you need to look at total value of employment, not looking just at the remuneration. Security. Do you want to have a job for some time? That is a big problem. A lot of companies are raising security, so security might be a big draw. Recognition, obviously, personal growth, development, work itself, would you enjoy your work? And there is obviously remuneration, benefits, compensation, and others. So organizations should customize based on their culture so they attract people that they want to attract, just like Google does. They attract people that share their culture, share their values, performance-oriented, even if it takes 14 interviews. And, okay, that's we already looked. So that's also a bit more. And there is examples if you share, that's Google, and that's it. So questions. Sorry, I think that I was over ambitious trying to tell you all about managed, and it's getting a bit difficult.
I think we have had some questions, and based on your experience, or if you are in your company, if you move around, or if you have foreign assignments, or a bit interested to listen a little bit to that, discuss this with Natalie. Yeah. I mean, like, oh, okay. I mean, a question that I had was a little bit to see. I mean, we talk about a global mindset or cultural agility. So, I don't know, I'm often wondering, you know, can we teach that, or how do we get that? Is this through experience? Or you have a lot of short-term assignments, so you gain experience, and then you're better prepared for a long-term assignment? Or if I'm sitting in a class, if I'm taking, I don't know, an MBA program, can I learn that to be more cultural?
The question is just as we discussed leadership. Can you teach a person to be a leader, born or taught? And there are schools of thoughts, but idea is very kind of, the jury is still out, but the idea is that some people have kind of personality that's teachable to lead others. The same thing works cross-culturally. There are some things that works in every situation. So you can lead people if you do this, 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 and this. Some do it better, some do it worse, but basically the same way as playing music instrument. Now, most people can be taught if you start early enough and practice, practice, practice. So in a way, yes, you should give the basic and then practice. So expertise development kind of approach tells us that you need 10,000 hours of practice to become an expert. So it basically takes 5 years of normal life to become an expert in anything, be it playing basketball or music instruments or becoming a leader. And obviously you need the same thing as in any teaching and learning. You need mentors, somebody who would say, you've done it well, this you handle not so well, you should have done something differently, let's see what you could have done. So you need somebody to mentor you, to provide you constructive feedback. If you just do things, it's not going to improve. You know, you can play, I don't know, football all your life and still never make the national team or even become drastically better. You just enjoy yourself. You need, you know, team, you need feedback, you need training, you need your coach to tell you what are your strengths and what to do with your weaknesses. So a bit a broad answer, but yes, if we're stuck long enough, teach and, you know, continue for long enough time. Probably it would not happen in the MBA program, but we can share knowledge that, you know, we already know what helps and what hurts. Well, maybe Maybe they prefer in... I understand, you know, most things, not global mindset, but yes, so I understand some, and Sasha will help me with the rest. Well, you have to ask questions, or I am going to go over the compensation. you have a question. Yes, actually, that's a very good question, because that is something, again, that we don't discuss. I did not want to get deep into theoretical discussion, but when I was conducting my research, I found out that some cultures were considered to be more easy to learn, more open, because, as I said, that's two-way street. I am trying to adjust, but if everybody looks at me and say, you are not one of us, we are not even going to tell you what you are doing wrong, you never learn. So yes, some countries are providing training, services, mostly obviously for migrants. So immigrants or somebody who is a refugee, but kind of temporary, they provide training. Some countries really very difficult to adjust. And there is some ideas like how easy to make friends. Do people work with each other? There is a whole kind of research things about cultural differences. Normally countries that are more open to experience, kind of don't, uncertainty avoidance is low, they are easier to connect because there are no taboos, or maybe very limited taboos. So you cannot do wrong. Differences are encouraged and celebrated, and foreigners are kind of considered to be wonderful people that you want to meet and discuss. Why countries that are high uncertainty avoidance, they tend to be closed. It's close families, you cannot make friends, people don't want to talk to foreigners, and there's very strict rules what you do and what you don't do. And when you break them, and you might not even know since they're unwritten, that's kind of serious thing. That's, so yes, you obviously, what countries can do to make more open, obviously encourage events, social events, and also preparation and teaching. But again, it's probably more for the citizens or new arrivals, not for the companies. But, you know, citizens, new arrivals might also be working at some companies.
Yeah, we were talking about this, you know, the, I don't know if you did hear about digital nomads.
Mm.
Yeah, so I don't know, it's a topic I'm very interested in. I don't know much about it, but I see that, for instance, Medellin became very popular for digital nomads. So, and I know that many people who come here are very, I mean, especially in Medellin, very happy to stay and to, I don't know, maybe, yeah, it's something, the tourism-related factor, the environment, the climate, the people, the...
Colombia, as I said, made in the best 10 countries in the world for, well, expats, but of course we use it for new people. Colombia in general, so maybe Medellin is more welcoming, and it's, there are different factors, but some of the things, that's how easy to meet people, how open people are to foreigners. Is it something that you can do on the street, at school, or do you need to know a person for 20 years before they, you know, start calling you by the first name? there are some very unusual countries you would not really, you know, expect to see best and worst, and that's not what, for example, United States did not make the best 10, so that's not surprisingly maybe, but definitely surprising for US citizens. I think I got the gist, but you just.
I mean, the difference between some cultures, so you are from Medellin, from Bogota, from the coast, so you know, there's, different cultures, and that people are more open to foreigners who come, say, from Europe or to the US than to their own countrymen.
That's not unique for Colombia. Every place we came and stay, we were told that people in other region are totally different. In Finland, if you're from the east, you barely understand people from the west. They speak in different, you know, kind of accent, and people of the west are very quiet and all that. So there is perception everywhere, and that's true, because I talked about cultural distance, so how easy you understand the other culture. Not surprisingly, if it's too small, their neighbors, it's not easier to adjust, because you assume similarity. You say, well, but we're just the same. We are from Colombia. So if you talk to me, for example, if I do something unusual, if I, you know, behave unusual, it's like, well, yes, that's foreigners, you know. Where is she from? Oh, yeah. That's what you would expect. So, or you will check that. But between neighbors, the assumption that you should understand, and if you don't, there is problems, and also not, I think you mentioned that, as far as I understood, that the history of conflicts in the past. So you probably have no ideas what conflicts you might have, say, with Finland. But with the neighbors, there were conflicts, and they still that. So it's common, and we have to keep in mind that when we talk about culture, again, it does not exist as a climate, and even climate is different. But it's more like middle thing. And the regional culture might be differences are larger inside the culture. Okay, so it looks like a bell curve, right? So from one extreme to another, the difference is bigger than if you compare two cultures. Probably should have drawn it, but I'm not good. Then you compare the medium. So a typical Colombian would be closer to typical US person. That's extremes would be to each other. It's just like, so that's one of the explanations, well, kind of two. But that happens, and that's why I'm talking about diversity of cultures. You cannot say it's, you know, somebody coming from United States to Colombia. You don't come to Colombia, you come to Cali, and that's, you know, special region, and it's special culture. I can see right now that Tiefit has different culture than Javeriana. You can see it, you can feel it. People look different, dress different, speak different, the building different. So there's small but intense culture. So you have to take all that into consideration.
Maybe I have one
Yeah, yeah. Oh, no, that's...
Of course. I just met a person here in Medellin that is working. I don't know if that's digital nomads, but he works for a company that people from all around the world that they work virtually, they pay to an agency, and they want to spend 1 month here working, one in Medellin, one in China, and all around the world. And he works for this agency. He prepares everything, like workplaces, apartments, and help the people here to do tourism or visit places. And I think that's a way to learn about my global mindset. I mean, these people that travel all around the world, they say that what they try to do is like learn knowledge about different cultures and learn about global mindset. And I think that the companies where they work, they encourage those employees to travel and gain about that, all the different cultures. But is that happening in different countries? I mean, is it increasing? Are they multinationals trying to work in that way, like contracting agencies to provide that services?
Yes, as I mentioned, that many companies use contracting agencies because there is move from less job security to more flexibility, which is obviously good for companies. And if you want to learn and move, that's of course a good opportunity. I have to, being from HR, kind of way take a duck of you and say, okay, but what if you don't want to move? What if you really like to stay in one place? It's nice when you want to move, you want to travel, when maybe you don't have family yet already, that's wonderful. But it's really good thing to be exposed to culture, understand, do you enjoy it, do you like that? But keep in mind what I said about honeymoon. So you're always having good time, never getting the bad pieces. So you are really not learning to deal with conflicts. You just kind of stay at the level of adaptation. And for employers, it might be a negative side. So we have to take that into consideration, that you don't have job security. It's like any gig economy. It's wonderful when it's an addition, when you enjoy it, when it's provide you flexibility. But what if you really want to work normal, traditional life, support the family, buy the house, all other things? Then you wouldn't be able to do that because you're in China. And you might not want to go to China. So that's kind of pluses and minuses, but it's a good idea to start if that's your goal. Companies use it more for flexibility, not for developing employees. There are no real investment in employees in this way. No, good.
just one point is that for me it's easy to understand that you explained when you take into consideration, for example, multinationals. But what is your point of view about the degree of human maturity in Colombian companies? I mean, taking into consideration that in the best case, we have, for example, one Colombia that has presence in Latam, but not in worldwide. What is your point regarding the reality here in Colombia?
Well, I'm afraid I'm not doing research in Colombia. I just have students like you are, so my point of view is limited. I have to say that it's just very casual observations and gained from discussion with students. So I think, yes, that there is a lot of room to grow more multinational, that's having more diversity in opinions, views, approaches. I think that's much less different flexible work, multicultural employers and all that here. Then, for example, in Europe, definitely then in the United States. On the other hand, I would not say that companies should diversify for the sake of diversification. It's just like any other things. You should know why you are doing that. Maybe it works the best to have employers that stay here, that come from here, and understand customers. If you need, there is different discussion why diversity is a strength, but not always. You should not be doing it just because everybody else is doing. It's almost like bringing dogs to work. So, you know, nice thing to have. Everybody is talking about you. So I think it's important to see on the strategic direction of the company. What they're trying to do, what their approach to customer service, what is their strategy, and then see if, what kind of employees they need, and if part of that would be different cultures, that might be the case. But you should not be doing this just for the sake of doing that. Did I answer your question? Sorry, I just could not get an opinion really very, you know, informed. And just
de su percepción, ¿qué considera usted que le hace falta al profesional colombiano para preparar para tener una experiencia internacional laboral?
How were they prepared?
Yeah, how you prepare yourself, or what skills do you need, like as a Colombian, to be more prepared to move, you know, from
well. Okay. I don't think you need any special skill as Colombian. So that's really not a handicap. Probably quite the opposite. That's it's really mostly positive attitude in the world from people coming from Colombia. So, but the steps like for any other thing. So if you are thinking about moving to another specific culture, you need to understand that culture and you need to understand it from the point of view of Colombians. So if you, for example, planning to go to Finland, you probably should not talk to US person or, you know, somebody who's been there but would have a different point of view. The best thing is to find materials or compare with somebody from Colombia or culturally close environment. So there is a lot of Ecuadorian in Finland. I have no idea why. So you might. So find about history, art. There is also ways that you can look at it again. It's outside. That's their cultural tools that compare countries. So you can see how they really. Where they fall on different cultural dimension, for example, how collectivistic they are, what is their power distance, what does it mean? So there are tools you can use, but you know we cannot really discuss them. But I think the important way to prepare is basically be very, very curious, actually. That's curiosity is important. So you should be able and kind of willing to talk to people about all kinds of things. So not just about culture, not about things, but and be prepared that you will be misunderstood, that this would not be really an exciting experience, and any learning beginnings are hard. You know, it's really hard to know what is going to happen. But positive, something that we all assume we have. I'm positive, I'm empathetic, I love other culture, you know, all this kind of things. But really it's challenging to deal with people that's whose values you don't understand. So the best thing I would, that's what I actually do. It's really quite unusual suggestions, but it's worked quite well. When I'm interested in new culture and prepare to move there, first I try to read books written by local authors, and then the most important things actually read books for children. And that's normally not what you do, kind of children books. So Because in children books, the values, expectations are explained very simply, because we're teaching children how we should behave in this environment. What's good, what's bad, who are good people. And they're very different. If you read folk stories in different countries, you would be surprised how different is the moral. You know, what's good, what's bad. So that's an easy, and watch movies and, you know, maybe make Facebook friends with expats living there, or better yet, with locals. So that's how I would start preparation from scratch. Thank you. Wow. In China, they clap back. When they clap, it's everybody. So thank you very much for being a good audience and for your questions and for coming.